Before we begin, I want to quickly talk about edubirdie.com. If you are in school or college and are struggling with your academic papers, be sure to check them out. They are a professional essay writing service and can help you out in a big way. The NBA may not have had much parity at the top over the past few years, with LeBron James and the Warriors meeting in the finals four straight times, but for the most part, the league as a whole has had good parity in the middle. No team is ever depressingly bad for long periods of time without eventually turning their luck around, and every team in the league has made the playoffs at least once in the last 10 years. Well, except for one. One painfully unfortunate franchise has been at the bottom of the totem pole trying to turn things around for 12 years now, which is the amount of time they have gone without a playoff appearance. That team is the Sacramento Kings, and that brings us to the topic of today's video. Today, we'll be talking about how the Kings' season has been going so far, and how I see it progressing as the season goes on. Before I start though, make sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel, as all support is very much appreciated. Now with that being said, let's begin. As I mentioned before, the Kings are in the midst of one of the worst stretches an NBA franchise has ever been through. Ever since their 2006 playoff berth, where they lost to the Spurs in the first round, the team has been on the outside looking in. In this same stretch, they have been known to whiff on almost every move they make, whether it be trades, free agent signings, or draft picks. Even the draft picks that have worked out in their favor never amounted to anything in regards to team success, as DeMarcus Cousins became a bona fide star in the league on the Kings, yet didn't see any playoff action in his time there. Going into this season, the Kings had little to no expectations at all besides developing the young players on the team. Almost everybody in the industry picked the Kings to finish near the bottom of the NBA in the preseason, and for good reason. They were one of the worst teams last year, and on paper, the team didn't make any major moves that stand out in regards to improving the team. So far this season, though, the Kings have been shocking everyone out of the gate. They have a winning record of 8-6, which has them in the 8th seed in the West at the moment. It hasn't even necessarily been because of an easy schedule early on either, because they've competed with and beaten some very good teams. Their biggest win came last game against the Spurs, which was absolutely thrilling to watch as a basketball fan, and they also beat the Thunder, Wizards, Grizzlies, Heat, and Timberwolves this season, who were all off-season favorites to at least be in contention for a playoff spot. So now, the two biggest questions worth discussing and answering are how have they managed to improve so much this year, and is the level of success they have seen so far sustainable? First, the biggest reason the Kings have seen so much improvement this year is because of their second-year point guard De'Aaron Fox and the massive leap he has taken from last year to this year. Last season, Fox's rookie year saw a lot of up and downs, which is typical for rookie guards though. He wasn't very efficient, he struggled with turnovers at times, and he didn't always look comfortable running the offense of an NBA team. This is all typical rookie guard stuff, though. Now this year, he looks like a brand new player. He's averaging 18.7 points, 7.1 assists, and 1.3 steals per game, which are all up from a year ago by a big amount. The most impressive part of the leap he's taken is with his efficiency, because he's shooting the ball 50.8% from the field and 44.2% from three, which are both amazing marks. It is still early, so over time he should revert back to a more normal number, but three-point shooting was one of his biggest weaknesses since his college days. And if he can pose as a consistent threat from deep, then the rest of his offensive game will come so easy to him, as it has been this year. Fox is one of the fastest players in the NBA as well, and he uses that to his advantage by consistently pushing the pace and putting pressure on opposing defenses. His presence on the court for the Kings is felt by everyone around him, and the numbers back it up. When Fox is on the court, the Kings have a net rating of +6, meaning they outscore opponents by 6 points per 100 possessions. When he's on the bench, though, that number drops all the way down to -15, meaning the Kings are basically getting blown out of the water without their second-year floor general on the court. When it comes to talking about the best players from the 2017 draft, Jason Tatum and Donovan Mitchell typically get all of the buzz in that regard. But De'Aaron Fox belongs in that conversation as well, yet gets none of the recognition. For comparison, Tatum is averaging 16.1 points, 7 rebounds, and 2.5 assists per game, while shooting 41.3% from the field and 38.6% from 3. He's efficient from 3 like he was last year, but his overall efficiency has taken a dip because he likes to shoot a lot of difficult, contested mid-range jumpers. He worked with Kobe this summer and probably tried to pick up on a few of his moves, but Kobe wasn't exactly known for taking smart shots in his heyday. He just made a lot of them because he's one of the greatest players ever. Fox stays within his limits, plays to his strengths, and his overall skill set on offense between playmaking and scoring, along with his defense, makes the conversation interesting. With Mitchell, he has also taken a step back this year. His inefficiency last year was something people brushed off because he was a rookie, which is perfectly fine. This year, though, he's actually regressed, which is inexcusable. His points per game may have gone up, but him shooting 41.7% from the field and only 30.1% from three are subpar numbers. He's trending more so towards being a volume scorer in the NBA than a consistently great one. And again, Fox's overall production in every capacity make the debate between those two worth having. Now, I've talked a lot about Fox, and for good reason, but it hasn't just been him elevating the Kings. The next player that has been a reliable weapon for the Kings is Buddy Hield. Hield got traded to the Kings during his rookie season 2 years ago, and ever since his arrival in Sacramento, he has been nothing short of a sharpshooter. He shot 42.8% from three during his rookie season in 25 games with the Kings, but that's a small sample size, so it might not be trustworthy. He then shot 43.1% from three last year in 80 games. Now this year, he's shooting 42.9% from three, so you see how this number is no fluke, and he is consistently great from deep. His floor spacing has been huge for the Kings, and has opened up lanes for Fox to operate when he gets more comfortable. This is exactly what he was drafted to do, and while he may not be quite on the level of Klay Thompson and Steph Curry, who were two of his unrealistic pre-draft comparisons, he has still been one of the best shooters in the entire NBA that has flown under the radar because he's on the Kings. These two have been a great backcourt leading the way to open things up for everybody else on the team. Iman Shumpert is a name that hasn't been on anyone's radar since the Cavs' 2016 championship run, yet he's given the team good minutes on both sides of the ball. Second overall pick from this year's draft, Marvin Bagley, has been productive off the bench, scoring about 12 points efficiently per night. And while it is odd that someone drafted that high isn't starting immediately, it is for good reason. The Kings signed Nemanja Bjelica this summer, and he has been playing better basketball this year than he ever played in his Timberwolves career prior to this. He's been nothing short of a flamethrower out the gate, knocking down 51% of his threes this year, and there isn't a spot on the floor that he isn't comfortable with pulling from. His overall versatility as a defender and passer have been a plus two, adding yet another weapon to the team after he was probably misused and as a result underrated in the past. The last player that deserves a shout out in this video is Willie Cauley-Stein, who has gotten better every year he's been in the league. When he was drafted, he was a clumsy big man with no real skill on the offensive end, and now that couldn't be further from the truth. He not only poses as a lob threat in the pick and roll because of his athleticism, but he's even developed some reliable post moves to go to and rely on. He's the team's third leading scorer at 16.5 points per game, and adding that to his rim protection on defense, he's become a nice two-way player. Overall, I've focused on all of the positives in this video and what the Kings have done well, but by no means am I saying that they're destined to be a playoff team immediately. While they're in 8th place in the West at the moment, they have a tough schedule coming up that will test them. Their youth has shown a ton of promise, but I don't believe that they're good enough to make the playoffs this year, and that's okay. Most people picked them to finish last in the West anyway, so just competing every night and playing a fun brand of basketball is super encouraging. They don't own their first round pick this year, so they have no reason to tank, so they're going to keep their foot on the gas all year long, which I'm happy about because I've really enjoyed watching them play. They've surprised a lot of people so far, and moving forward, this core could become something special if they stick together. And with that being said, that's all I have for you today. Remember to like the video and subscribe to the channel for more NBA content coming soon. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.